head was about to explode and the light hurt my eyes. I needed my sunglasses and painkillers to dull the pain. In one of my finer moments of self-deception, I swore to quit drinking.
And of course we know where the sunglasses are, because he needs those for emergency Duke Nukem situations.
Ugh. The sunglasses made the world look bearable. Now I could keep my eyes open without feeling like a vampire in the sun.
Don't worry, girls. There's plenty of wake to go around.
The pills worked fast. The prospect of being awake started to seem bearable again. There was a message waiting for me on the machine.
You have one new message.
Ow! Are you still asleep? Wakey, wakey! You should have your show on your TiVo. If Alice wasn't too mad to record it, as she called me earlier and really chewed me out. Yeah, we went a little overboard last night. But parties are a part of this business. Al, look, I'm saying this as your friend. She's not doing your career any favors by trying to run your life like that, okay? I'll talk to you later, Al. Watch the show!
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to the Harry Garrett Show.
Thank you. Thank you, everybody. We have a great show tonight. I've been talking with the best-selling author, Alan Wake, about his new book, The Sudden Stop.
Yeah, good read. Go buy it.
No, it is a good read. Look, I'm going to be honest here.
Is that wise?
No, but I'm going to do it anyway. I got people who give me the lowdown on books. I'm a busy guy. But this one, I actually read from cover to cover. I mean, I'm a big fan.
Wow, thanks.
Now, this might be a spoiler for those who haven't read the book yet, based on the sales figures, the two people out there who haven't read the book yet. But this last book is all about the death of the main character, the hard-boiled New York detective, Alex Casey. Now, there's been a lot of outrage about this. Why the hell did you kill Casey? What the hell were you thinking, man?
Good riddance. No, seriously, though. 7 years and 6 books is a long time. He was a gloomy guy to spend all your working hours with, and it was a good run. But it's time to explore new things. My next book will be a departure from the old for me.
You selfish bastard, always thinking of yourself. Well, you've certainly given us a lot of entertainment over the years. And now that you mention it, Casey was a gloomy guy. Never had much luck with his love life with the ladies. Was that autobiographical in any way?
Yeah, no kidding. Casey's lady friends tended to die on him. With Casey, it was all about his pain. No, nothing autobiographical about that. I'm a happily married man. My wife is my muse.
Well, congratulations. That's great to hear. So, how's the publicity tour been treating you?
Good. Great. But I gotta say, I'm glad to be back home in New York.
Well, you've certainly been on the news a lot lately. Lots of parties and, you got into a fight with some paparazzi.
Oh, man. Well, that guy was really in my face. I lost my temper. I know that wasn't cool.
Well, you are famous for that temper.
Well, I did also write several books.
Well, your latest novel is called The Sudden Stop, and it's in bookstores now. Go get it. That means the two of you out there who haven't bought it yet. Ladies and gentlemen, that's all we have for you tonight. I want to thank all our guests for the evening. Alan Wake, Sam Lake. Once more, do the face for a Sam. There it is. And our musical guests, Poets of the Fall. Thank you, and good night.
At least I'd been funny. I told myself I could live with that.
Hey, honey. Did you watch the show?
I didn't say anything stupid, if that's what you want to know.
Okay, Grumpy. You want an aspirin or something?
Are you going to start with me about drinking now?
You know what? Go back to sleep, Alan.
What? Now you can't even talk to me?
Well, this morning I was angry because you said you'd be home at midnight and you showed up at 7 a.m. and passed out in mid-sentence. Now I'm over it. Are you angry?
This goddamn tour. It's gotten out of hand.
Oh, honey. It's almost over, right? We can get back to normal. Then you can start writing again.
I'm sorry, honey.
Alan, you're not thinking straight. Just take a shower and go back to bed, huh?
Yeah, you're right, honey. I'm sorry. Once this is over, let's go away together. A vacation. Just you and me. Some peace and quiet. Somehow, the clicker was the key to the cabin. I had to return to Cauldron Lake to save Alice. I'm going back to the lake to finish this. I'm going to write an ending to the story in the manuscript on my own terms, to make it all right.
Why can't you just write it here?
The last page is still in the typewriter. I need to read it first. Everything needs to be just right. Zane tried to cut some corners, and it didn't end well.
Okay, ready when you are.
I'm sorry, Sarah, but I need to do this alone. Barry, take her gun. Miss Weaver, close the door when I leave.
Good luck, Al.
See you later. Warm and sunny. I'd flicked the switch of the clicker. Had it done this? I didn't stop to question it. I had to take advantage of the sunlight to get to the lake. On Zane's page, I'd stood on the rim of Cauldron Lake, about to use the clicker. That's where I was headed. Surrounded by the beauty of the Pacific Northwest landscape, it was hard not to let doubt creep in one last time. I could still chalk everything up to a dream, a delusion. I had enough imagination to make up something like this, having been in the cabin all this time, trapped in a story inside my head, gone mad from grief over Alice's death like Hartman had claimed. There would be no way of knowing. I told myself it didn't really matter. My course was set.
I just have to do this real quick. Yeah! Now that the car's wrecked, we can head on over. And I noticed that even though Barry was crying and acting all broken up, he didn't seem to care enough about us to give us the Flaming Eye of Mordor. I think having a headlamp would be pretty useful, just in case. Of course, it is daylight outside, so it should be a straight shot right on over to Cauldron Lake. I mean, when has something ever gone wrong? During the daytime. Gotta do it. Yeah! Some fantastic technical driving skills there, Wake. Should be proud. So there's never any traffic on these roads. It's like you're completely isolated, even during the daytime. Huh.
The darkness had touched me. There was a link between us, always would be. I could feel its presence again, getting closer.
Well, didn't say day for very long. Very unfortunate for us, too, because I think we probably still had a little bit of a way to go.
The Dark Presence was no longer trying to capture the writer so he could create the ending it wanted. The writer knew too much. He was too strong, and he carried a weapon left behind by Thomas Zane, something that could hurt it. Now, the darkness was doing everything in its power to simply stop the rider from ever reaching Cauldron Lake and the dark place it came from.
So someone in the thread was actually mentioning they didn't really understand why the darkness was starting to come after Wake now, trying to kill him, but when it wasn't before. And that's pretty much because he was able, when he was writing before, it was able to edit it to where it would make itself stronger without him knowing it. But now he's kind of gotten a little too smart for the darkness and has learned how to work around it for his own means. So now it seems that the darkness is pretty strong. I guess it's just happy with what it has right now and doesn't want to risk losing it. Make a quick pit stop in here. There might be something good, and we got an emergency box here in the first place, so no more revolver ammo and batteries. Not the best find, but I'm sure there's gonna be something better in here.
Based on the signature in the motel register, Agent Nightingale had stayed here, in room number 2.
Hey, there's something good. Glad we stopped by. Odd. Let's go check. Okay. I guess nothing happened. Yeah, might as well go check some of these other rooms here before we go into Nightingale's room.
This had obviously been the room where Agent Nightingale had stayed when he hadn't been busy harassing me.
Not the tidiest fellow. He's got pictures of just about everybody in the town that we've met. And some snapshots of the town as well. And more importantly, he brought some flashbangs with him.
Look after yourself and your co-workers!
Could have been me.
Now, I really didn't notice anything special about that Taken, mostly because of all the effects around him. And speaking of effects, this car has some really weird effects going on, where you've got like a shattered windshield just floating outside of it, if you can see it. Anyway, I think that was actually supposed to be a Taken version of Agent Nightingale, just judging off of what Alan had to say. Though I couldn't really tell because of all the effects and how quickly he died. There's a few extra areas around here that you can explore if you want. Honestly, this area is really kind of frantic with the Taken just popping out of the roads, and there are a lot of possessed objects around in this area. So it's best to just try to avoid them as best you can. Speaking of possessed objects, this bridge is full of them.
What the hell?
Actually cut it pretty close there. This bridge is one of the more difficult parts of this level because it's very narrow. You can't really maneuver around it, and there are a lot of possessed objects. And unlike before, there's hardly anywhere to actually put between yourself and the objects. It's so you're pretty much stuck using flares, which I have to drop just about all of mine in this area. And then there's this. This doesn't actually seem to shy away from the flares nearly as much as the other things do. So, a flashbang with a direct hit will take away just about all of its shield, which is nice. And despite what it might seem, that is nowhere near the most active area. We are just scratching the surface in this level. Might be the most possessed object-heavy area of the level, but it is by no means the busiest. Yes, new enemy is a possessed monster truck. Maybe not a monster truck, but I'll just call it that for the sake of calling it that. I don't really want to be too specific. In a truck. Either way, it's got a loud engine. Sounds pretty scary when you're actually trapped in this building trying to get out. Kind of a little strange that they made the entire upstairs of this barn simply for one flare. But we were completely out of flares before, so hey, I'm not gonna complain. And now the problem with having parked right in front of the doorway here. They've got this other big doorway on the side, but they've got a lot of beams and posts getting in the way. Because of the light, it can be a little hard to see and maneuver around here. So we've got a fresh truck, but I guess Alan had the presence of mind to stick the parking brake onto that other car in front of us. So we can't even push it aside. Now we just wind up duplicating Austin Powers a bit, going back and forth. But we finally got out. Hooray. Moving on. Completely ignore the fast taken, because though they are fast, we're faster. As you might have guessed, this is definitely the part of the game where the darkness says, alright, enough screwing around, you gotta get this guy. And that is exactly what it is trying to do. The darkness does not hold back anymore. You saw what it was doing on the bridge, and it was going nuts back there. I'll keep the double-barreled shotgun for the extra power. And I wonder, what happened to the owners of these cars? Were the cars just randomly parked around the campgrounds or something and thrown here, or
modern camping equipment is right, mate.
It could possibly be that the Taken in this area are the drivers of those cars. There we are, going through quite a few Taken. And that would explain the lack of drivers on the road earlier. Although you'd think that there'd be a lot more missing persons reports going on, and quite a few more FBI agents coming through, rather than just Nightingale. Of course, maybe that's what Nightingale was originally sent here for. There's a saying that Alan Wake had at the beginning of the game. It was about, it basically boiled down to the unanswered mysteries are sometimes the best. And that is really what this game starts doing towards the end. A lot of questions start getting raised a lot towards the end. Probably more than you will have had for the rest of the game. Now, I'm going to warn you that this part will probably leave you a little confused, and I'll try my best to explain that later. But for now, just know that this game does not answer a lot of its mysteries. A little information about this tunnel. This is probably one of the areas that I had the most difficulty
with. The bottom
with.
Of Cauldron Lake was a graveyard of things the lake had claimed in one way or another over the decades. The Dark Presence brought them up in its wake, scattering the rotten waterlogged hull of an old boat here, the remains of a long-ago crashed airplane there. Trees shattered under the impacts. The earth groaned. It didn't even notice.
That tunnel can be difficult if you just try to run through to this beam of light, because, you know, you saw me able to skip large portions of fighting simply because I was able to run from checkpoint to checkpoint. But this really is not the spot in the game to do it with. The best way to do it is to just take your time and go bit by bit. Because there's no areas where there are unlimited spawns of Taken. And despite having a lot of cars in this area, we also have a lot of gated areas that we have to find buttons to, which will take us out of the cars, out of safety, and you can bet that the enemies will capitalize on that. Something nice that they did with the combat system here is that they made it to where Alan Wake will look at other enemies that are nearby. So, you saw him looking off to the right earlier. That's how I knew that there was a guy coming off to my right. Now, I didn't really take advantage of that too well, but I've done it in previous videos, and it's very useful. Now we're kind of getting to the point where there's really no reason for the cans. There's never been a reason for cans to be here. The flashbangs to be here. But I don't think anyone's really going to complain because this is where they start throwing everything they've got at you. And of course they say that on the spawn on one person. I can actually hear some Taken in the building, but fortunately I'm smart, went out the side entrance, and got into the car before they could actually come out. You can hear them on the dirt back there. I could stick around here and run over the Taken and get rid of them, but that damages the car, and you don't want to break a car in a section where they specifically mean for you to have one. They do offer a lot of replacements, but I'd rather not run
out of my way. There had to be a way to power up the container lift. Zane cut its heart out, but it didn't die. The thing that wore Barbara's face kept crooning sweet nothings, sugar-laced with poison. He put on the suit, untied the monster from the chair. The thing in his arms thrashed weakly, but he held fast. He stepped outside, off the pier, and into the dark water, a sinking pinprick of light descending toward a bottom that never came.
And speaking of Zane, I don't think I mentioned this before in the Let's Play, but the voice actor for Thomas Zane and Alex Casey that we heard in the very beginning of the game is actually voiced by the same voice actor who voiced for Max Payne in all the Max Payne games. Remedy does like to go back to some of their previous staff throughout their different games, such as voice actors, some characters even, and musicians like Poets of the Fall. We all remember this boss fight. Not really too much of an issue now that we know how to deal with it, and we are very well supplied. Now, you just get it stuck on this wall and drop flares down, so it's no issue, really. You could actually potentially get in your car if you left it facing the right way and shine the lights on to the tractor, but I don't really think that I needed to do that, because it was easy enough. It only costs 2 flares. Flares are items that I use a bit more as expendables, rather than flashbangs and flare gun shots, which I tend to save for bigger areas or swarms.
When I told Barry my plan back in the well-lit room, I'd acted as if I knew what I was doing. I didn't. I was operating on the shifting logic of a dream. I had to fight my way to the lake through the horrors of the night. I had to flick an old battered light switch imbued with childhood magic. I had to write a happy ending to a horror story. I had to save my wife from the dark prison she was being held in.
Surprises there's actually writing this far out. There's actually a stash or two this far out as well. You'd think that Cauldron Lake, the very source of all the darkness, would be one of the last places that Cynthia would actually go to. Of course,
I will never give her to you.
There's also the possibility that it could have been Thomas Zane. You might have guessed, this is another area, kind of like the bridge, where you have a certain distance that you have to go by with pretty heavy opposition. But if you take my advice from before and just go patiently, then you can move through it fairly easily. This game never really makes you under-equipped. They throw flashbangs at you like crazy at this part, so you can start using them pretty liberally. Don't worry, Coffee. I'll get you out of here. Terrible camera angle game. Give me a new one. Now, fortunately, unlike the last spotlight area, this one doesn't last nearly as long. The last guy alive is actually just stuck behind that house, and he was hiding back there until we got off the searchlight. I think you can actually get on the spotlight again in this area. We've got some flare gun rounds. And 2 chainsaw guys, so might as well not bother messing around with them. case of emergency. Hey, we got some extra ammo for it too. Now, normally you'd be able to run through these areas fairly easily by dropping flares through doorways, and I guess they kind of caught on to that fact or already knew about it and didn't want you to do that. So they put in these things that you have to push out of the way. There's not a lot of them, but they only put them in this specific area.
The dark place I found myself in was unlike anything I could ever have imagined. It wasn't solid. It flowed. It was conceptual and subjective. For someone else, an artist in another field, it would have been very different. I could sense the story of the manuscript all around me, the words and ideas floating in the air, poised to become real.
Yeah, Wake, after this is over, you gotta go to the gym with Barry. I mean, sure, it looked heavy, but huffing and puffing. You're like Carmine when he tries to sprint.
I could see Mirror Peak in the distance. That's where Cauldron Lake was.
I really love the pacing that they have in this part of the game. Oh, sweet. We get a ride in a car? Yeah, let's go! Okay, it's gonna speed up any second now. We're about to go down a hill. Alright. Oh, it's no Donkey Kong country, that's for sure. And Wade can barely stand in it, let alone jump in it. In this area that I especially like, it's how you've got all the darkness around you. You know that there's Taken all around you. You can see all the birds in the sky. You can see like the thick fog all around, long stretches to go. And you can see off in the distance just a little bit of light ahead. Gives you a visible goal to reach. And it's kind of like there's a little bit of safety in all of the darkness, especially since you're moving towards Cauldron Lake, which is the very center of all the darkness. I've learned about Alan's love of coffee, his one weakness. We're exploiting his weakness of coffee. Leave the coffee alone. It's innocent. Yeah, achieve mode. My gamer score is gonna be Titanic! Oh wait, it's Steam. Doesn't have a gamer score. Well, I can show off to all of you guys watching. Another thing that you do well with this area is they kind of have different areas that are specific for enemies. Like we had a lot of chainsaw and like heavy chainsaw guys in the back, and then before that we had possessed objects, and then we had birds, and now we're moving on to another enemy type, and you will see them very soon. very rare moment in the very ending of this game to have it actually be quiet. It's kind of eerie, actually. That's better.
Damn.
Welcome to the new enemy of this area. Fast guys. There's gotta be a name for them, I guess. Sprinters, maybe? I just call them fast guys. I don't think that Alan Wake ever actually names them. Yeah, come charge me. Aww. Right in the generator. Crotch shot to death. Even though there's no enemies I need safety from, might as well fire this up to get a checkpoint. Just in case something goes horribly, horribly wrong. Boat propeller. Huh. What am I also gonna get tossed our way?
Shit.
It's like part of a boat. Come on, get over here. Not gonna bother with it. Still got 5 flashbangs left. Okay, you know what? If you don't want to do this, then I will just go. Clearly you have no interest in this, so why should I? Oh god, there's coffee in there. Gotta go for it. How's that for a dodge? And very, very nice of the coffee, actually. Led us to quite a good spot. Gave us 2 more flashbangs and 1 choke point. Enemies can't get in from the sides that I have noticed. But of course, these fast guys, they don't really seem too interested in trying to attack me, so they kind of just follow you to make sure that you know that they're still there, and they're not really going to do much. Thanks for the help. And still, the darkness insists on helping us go farther towards them. Oh. I got it really close there. I was too busy completely owning his friend. No, Alan Wake's just showing no respect for those fast guys. Up in his face, just popping him with a pistol like he's nothing. Now, to be fair, Wake, you've seen much stranger things like that. Things than that. Such as, oh, I don't know, a boat thrown through a trailer park. You wouldn't care about that now, would you? Yeah, Darkness, it's not really getting the message through to him. He doesn't care about boats. Try something else. Hey, a stash. That's what we got in here. Flashbangs, flares. That's actually a very good stash. I think we're doing pretty good on flare gun ammo too, so that gave us just about all that we needed. I'm sure this won't be a source for a big fight or anything. Wait a minute. Red button. Where do these power lines go to? Just gonna cut out the middleman, see if I can avoid a spawn. But just in case if enemies spawn when I start using this. Oh, of course not. They spawn after I use it. Well, that's fine. Got a lot of power lines here, so I'm sure we can utilize these some. Wow, we got a lot of stuff here. Flashbangs and flare gun ammo. Got 10 shots with a flare gun. Well, that's one enemy down to the power lines. Fortunately for us, one of the most difficult ones. Yeah, screw this. We got plenty of flare gun ammo. And if they're throwing this many enemies at us, I'm pretty sure that this is getting towards the end. That was actually pretty easy. See, if you hoard all of your stuff, then once you get to the difficult parts, you can make it laughably easy. Which, I don't know if that's a sign of bad pacing or development or just me breaking the game, but either way, the game is still fun with the combat sections, even if you can break the hard parts.
After Zane had gone, I stood alone in the shifting dream that was the dark place. I had to find a way to the cabin. I'd written myself a way through this place in the manuscript. I followed the idea of a path. I'd written myself across the ocean that blocked my way, and with that, there was a bridge to the island beyond. The idea of the cabin flickered in the underwater darkness. I willed the cabin to be real, and it was.
Turn back now.
If only we had flare guns. Oh, wait. It might seem like I'm going a bit overboard in this area. And well, I kind of am. But it is overboard.
Do as you're told.
At a very good time. Looks like we are coming right up on the lake.
I never loved you.
Looks a bit different since the last time we were here. Now, this is about as close to a final boss as you're gonna get. Basically, you want to use the flare gun, or your flashlight if you don't have any flares left, to try to break up some of these flying objects on the outer area so that you can get to this area and get all the flare gun ammo you could ever want. Now, not all these objects will break flight, and you don't have to break all of them. You just have to break enough so that you can cross. Some of these objects will actually come in really close towards the front panel, so I kind of just want to make sure that I want to get all of these down, so I'll be safe. And this is an unlimited store of flare gun ammo. Once you get to the center, just spam the center with flares.
It's all in your head. You're making this up.
having a bad dream. It was just another nightmare.
No.
Everything's fine. You're home.
It wasn't a dream.
Everything's fine.
Turn the lights on. Turn the lights on!
Shh, baby. The power's out. There's no light. Come back to bed and I'll make you forget all about your fear in the dark.
My fear? It's your fear. Why aren't you afraid? You're not Alice. Turn the lights on now. Where's the clicker? What did you do with it?
Alan, honey, you're still one foot in a dream. You're not making any sense. Come back to bed. Alan, you're scaring me now. Come back to bed. Have you taken your pills? Do you want me to call Dr. Hartman? I read your manuscript. It's brilliant. Departure is your best work yet. You're a genius. I'm so proud of you. Come back to bed. We'll talk more about it in the morning. Come back to bed, Alan.
Come back to bed, Tom.
You must find your way to the cabin. It stands in your way. It won't let you pass. It has no heart. It's filled with darkness. You must fill its heart with light. Don't mind him. He's Mr. Sh- Your friends will meet him when you're gone. Use the clicker.
The idea of a path.
I'm leaving you.
What?
I'm leaving you, Alan. I met someone. I'm in love with someone else.
Alice? No, what are you saying? You can't.
You don't love me. How could you? You don't even love yourself. All you do is torture yourself with work you can't do anymore.
No, I love you more than anything in the world. You're my muse.
I'm not.
Who are you? What have you done with my Alice?
Alice? What are you doing? Put the light back on. What are you doing, Alan? Stop. Put the light back on.
It wasn't true. Nothing like that had ever happened. You're not my Barbara.
Tom, let me go. I promise to be good. Please, untie me, you naughty boy. I will help you write your masterpiece. I will love you forever.
No, you're not Barbara Jagger. I made a terrible mistake. I should have never written you back. You came back wrong. Your heart is filled with darkness.
Put that knife away, Thomas. Put it down.
Your heart is filled with darkness. I'll cut it out.
I'll
take you back to the depths you came from. Filled with darkness.
Get away from me, you hag! Where am I?
Now you will never get her back.
I am much older than you. Older than your first work of art. I will find a new face to wear. Someone else to dream me free.
I could feel Alice's presence close by. I understood what I had to do now. I knew how to write the ending to Departure. There's light and there's darkness. Cause and effect. There's guilt and there's atonement. But the scales always need to balance. Everything has a price. That's where Zane had gone wrong. There's a long journey through the night back into the light.
Oh, no!
And that is Alan Wake. Told you it would raise a lot more questions than it would actually answer, especially towards the end. Those last few cutscenes have driven people nuts. There's a few things. The creation of Mr. Scratch by Thomas Zane. That has led to a lot of different possible explanations for the entire game. The reason for that is, we saw that when Alan started typing, when he got into the cabin, time went back, and we saw Alan diving into the lake, and then time went forward. So, some people have thought that that actually meant that we were actually playing as Mr. Scratch the entire time. Because he said that, Thomas Zane said that Mr. Scratch would, I believe he said that he would be with our friends while we were gone. So, people think that we play Mr. Scratch throughout the entire game, and Alan was just sitting in the cabin that entire time. There's also the thought that, you know, it's just straightforward, which I guess you could take it that way, but I think, personally, that the Mr. Scratch theory makes a bit more sense. And then we have the very last line of the game, it's not a lake, it's an ocean. That, for a lot of people, means that rather than the lake being isolated and it being the only way for the darkness to get out, the fact that it's an ocean means that it's larger and more spread out, meaning that the darkness can actually leave through multiple spots in the world, not just Cauldron Lake. That's just the one that we know of. So it's possible that there are multiple points for the darkness to escape into the real world. So yeah, that is Alan Wake. That was one of my favorite games that I have ever played. And it's not over yet. We still have the two DLC chapters to go through, and after doing those, I will be going through American Nightmare. So don't worry, there is plenty more Alan Wake to come. Which is good. I've played through American Nightmare, and it is quite a bit of fun. It's not nearly as long as Alan Wake, and it's not as in-depth or groundbreaking, but in terms of gameplay, they did make quite a few good strides in it, and the story isn't bad. It focuses a good bit on Alan after the cabin, once he's learned a lot more about how to exploit the darkness for his own means. And it also focuses more on Mr. Scratch as well. So we will see a few more answers in that. And we'll get some more answers in the DLC as well. That was one of the main reasons why the DLC was created. It was created to answer some questions, since those last few cutscenes really confused a whole lot of people. And I think led to some great discussion about the overall meaning of the game, and made the game story one of the best I have ever seen in a video game. Anyway, stay tuned for more Alan Wake. Thanks a lot for watching this. I will see you in the DLC and in American Nightmare.
That one's so the light.